Ivermectin is a cheap and widely available drug that is getting a lot of buzz right now, with its potential to prevent and treat COVID-19, which I'm cautiously optimistic about. We've seen the hype before with different drugs that ultimately didn't pan out. For ivermectin, the buzz started when researchers in Australia showed that in vitro, meaning in a test tube, the SARS-CoV-2 replication was reduced about 5,000-fold over a 48-hour time span. Back in April, I made a video about this and explained how this drug is thought to inhibit viral replication. And it's also widely believed that it has anti-inflammatory properties as well. Since April, I've combed through multiple studies as scientists worldwide have been conducting many of them, and so far, 14 have been completed. But these studies are not without their flaws. There are retrospective studies, which introduces bias, and most of the studies have small numbers, and some studies are published as preprints before a thorough peer review process can be completed. The benefit of preprint studies being published is that knowledge can be quickly shared worldwide, and the hope is that prospective randomized studies will follow these observational or anecdotal studies. The drawback is that studies are frequently published and retracted once they are more critically reviewed. For example, I was able to find 3 ivermectin preprint studies that have since been retracted. But I need to know, should I be prescribing ivermectin for COVID? If so, at what dose and for how long? Well, in this video, I'm going to be objectively breaking down these studies. The gold standard for a scientific trial is a prospective study that is double-blinded and randomized with a treatment and a control group. And it should be well-matched in as many variables as possible to reduce the risk that unforeseen factors and not the medication's action are causing the effect that researchers are studying. A prospective study enrolls participants to evaluate treatment protocol, follows them for side effects, and evaluates the results. A double-blinded study is one in which neither the investigators nor the treatment recipients know whether they have received the treatment or a placebo. Amid a pandemic, decision makers have been trying to balance the need for evidence-based medicine and good clinical practice with the urgent need for safe and effective treatments for COVID-19. Advocates who are on the side of pushing for more treatment protocols through this process, even if it means relying on substandard clinical evidence, they're going to argue that the death rate continues to increase and will argue that there is not enough time to justify a full prospective study, which can take months. They'll also note that the medications that they're choosing to treat COVID-19, they've been already FDA approved for other uses and therefore are considered safe, even if they've not been tested to verify safety and efficacy for COVID-19. Ivermectin is sold over the counter in many countries to treat people for animals and for parasitic worm infections. In countries in Latin America, such as Peru, Guatemala, Bolivia, it's been in great demand as people believe that it protects them from COVID-19. Researchers in Latin America point out that the evidence is scant that ivermectin protects against COVID-19. However, they have difficulty recruiting participants to run a clinical trial and test their hypotheses because nearly everyone has already taken the drug. Bias can lead to beliefs that become difficult to dislodge and question. If people believe medication will work, it can become difficult to get them to challenge this belief. Many will justify using unproven remedies by saying that it has a good safety profile and it's not going to hurt, even if it doesn't work. A zealous belief that a medication will cure can lead to users ignoring side effects, which is a confirmation bias. The maximum recommended dose for ivermectin is 200 micrograms per kilogram. Side effects are pretty rare, but include fatigue, abdominal pain, nausea, diarrhea, dizziness, and skin rashes. Less common side effects include worsening of asthma, Stevens-Johnson reaction, hepatitis, and jaundice. At high doses from an accidental overdose, it can cause seizures, numbness and tingling, ataxia, meaning difficulty maintaining balance. And then there's the potential for severe drug-to-drug interactions. Remember in the beginning of this video, I mentioned that the study that was done in Australia, where it was showed that it inhibited viral replication in vitro. Well, this leads to the question, what dose of ivermectin would be needed to achieve the same antiviral effect in a human being? So there are big questions with this, like even with the highest reported dose of 1700 micrograms per kilogram, which is 8.5 times the FDA approved dose, ivermectin's maximum plasma concentration was 0.28 micrograms. 93% of ivermectin is bound to plasma proteins, which limit its uptake into cells. When tissue concentration of ivermectin was studied in calves, it was insufficient to achieve an antiviral effect. So the author's conclusion from this study was that although higher doses of ivermectin are generally well tolerated, the The clinical effects of doses in the 5 micromolar range are unknown and may be associated with toxicity. And this is the big unknown. How much ivermectin do people need to treat COVID-19, and will that dose do more harm than good? The only way to know is by doing prospective randomized controlled trials that include different dosing regimens, which means you need a lot of people in these trials to get a concrete answer. There are currently 47 clinical trials registered at clinicaltrials.gov, and these trials are to study the effects of ivermectin on COVID-19, 14 of which have been completed. For the sake of organizing these studies for this video, I'll number them and I'll briefly discuss the most significant studies. So starting with study number 1, it was a randomized double-blind trial at Dhaka Medical College in Bangladesh. They looked at 400 people with mild COVID, half of which received ivermectin, 6 milligrams, along with doxycycline, 100 milligrams twice a day, and that was for 5 days. The other half, they received standard treatment for COVID. In the treatment group, 61% had early recovery, 23% had late recovery. In the placebo group, 44% had early recovery, and 37% had late recovery. Now, in the treatment group, 9% had a severe outcome, meaning the COVID progressed to more severe disease, and this was in comparison to 18% that was in the placebo group. So although this was not a huge study, the ones who received ivermectin and doxycycline, they did have better outcomes. Okay, the second study was an observational prospective trial at Yernakian Hospital in Argentina, where they enrolled 229 participants who were randomized and placed into 2 groups. 131 people received standard care and PPE plus topical iota carrageenan on the nasal and buccal mucosa, so within the cheek, and ivermectin topical on the oral mucosa, and the other received standard prophylactic measures along with the PPE. So participants were followed for 1 month. No participant in the treatment group tested positive for COVID-19, and 11% of the standard prophylactic group tested positive. Study number 3 was a randomized sequential assignment study with no masking at Zagazig University in Egypt, and it enrolled 340 patients. 228 received prophylactic ivermectin with a dosage based on weight and control group with no treatment. Participants were followed for 14 days. 7.4% of the treatment group and 58.4% of the control group developed symptoms of COVID. Then there was a randomized control trial done in Iraq where they enrolled 140 participants, half of which received 200 micrograms per kilogram of ivermectin, and they also received doxycycline. The other half received standard care. Researchers reported that the ivermectin with doxycycline group reduced the mean time to recovery from 17.9 days to 10.6 days, and the percentage of patients who progressed to more severe disease. Randomization was done by days of the week, but then limited by the number of enrollees with a subjective level of disease, which may have introduced bias. And there's another randomized controlled trial done in Egypt that enrolled 600 patients, 400 of which were symptomatic, and 200 were healthcare and household contacts. The participants were assigned to 6 different groups, which I'll show you right here. The study's endpoint was clinical improvement, 2 negative PCR tests at least 48 hours apart, and number of hospital days. So the study results, they were variable. This trial did not have a placebo arm, and the authors concluded that ivermectin was more effective in treatment and prophylaxis than the other group, which included hydroxychloroquine with standard care. But no placebo arm, so it's really hard to come to a solid conclusion. There's another retrospective observational study that was conducted looking at patients with hospitalized COVID from 4 different hospitals in Florida. The charts were reviewed for 280 patients, and 173 of them were treated with at least 1 ivermectin dose at 200 micrograms per kilogram, and 107 without ivermectin. Most patients in both groups also received hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, or both. The researchers found lower mortality in the ivermectin group with an absolute risk reduction of 11% and no difference in median length of stay or extubation rate, meaning who was able to come off the ventilator. Now, in the ivermectin group, the overall mortality rate was 15%. The mortality rate for those who received ivermectin and who had severe pulmonary involvement was 38.8%. In the non-ivermectin group, the overall mortality rate was 25%, and the mortality with severe pulmonary involvement was 80.7%. So the authors stated that their study had several limitations that may have introduced bias, including being in a retrospective study, a timing bias, and use of other medications like dexamethasone. The authors concluded by saying, further studies in appropriately designed randomized trials are recommended before any conclusions can be made. And there's also another study in Argentina that has not been completed yet, but it's a double-blinded randomized controlled trial and enrolled 500 people, and 250 of which in the treatment arm will be receiving ivermectin based on weight, and the other half is going to be receiving a placebo. The participants will be followed to evaluate the percentage who require hospitalization, time to hospitalization, and number of days in the hospital, and the percentage who need ICU level of care. The National Institute of Health, the NIH, on August 27th, 2020, made a strong recommendation against the use of ivermectin to treat COVID. This recommendation was based on expert opinion. Proponents for using ivermectin point out that this recommendation was made before many clinical trials on ivermectin were completed, and the recommendation needs to be updated. Now, reviewing the clinical trials to date show that many have flaws that make it difficult to draw scientific conclusions for a number of reasons. Will ivermectin work for both prevention and treatment of COVID-19? Maybe. I remain hopeful, and I think there's a good chance that it will work, as there is some evidence to suggest that it does. But instead of rushing to judgment as we did with hydroxychloroquine, convalescent plasma, and remdesivir, we need to wait for results of prospective, randomized, blinded studies with a placebo group. Studies must clearly demonstrate a causative relationship between using ivermectin and treatment or prevention of COVID-19 versus a correlative effect. A cheap, safe, and effective drug will bring the COVID-19 pandemic under control faster than a vaccination will. The data calls for regulatory agencies worldwide to invest in studies to provide definitive evidence one way or another. So for now, I'm not going to be prescribing it, but I hope that changes soon.